indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky, you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable. You see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters and to mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Great is your love and justice, God. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough,
your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me.
Heaven reaching down to us, your grace is enough for me. God, I sing your grace is enough, I'm covered in your love. Your grace is enough for me. For me. peacemaker, promise keeper, you finish what you begin. Our provision through the desert, you see it through to the end. You see it through. Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness you will lead us, and forever we will say, you're the Lord our God. The waiting, still we can know you are good. All your plans are for your glory. Yes, we can know you are good. Yes, we can know you are good. The Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness you will lead us, and forever we will say, you're the Lord our God. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. The Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness you will lead us, and forever we will say, you're the Lord our God. And forever we will say, you're the Lord our God. And forever we will say, you're the Lord our God. You're the Lord our God. The Lord our God.
Amen. Let's praise the Lord with our hands. Woo! You may be seated. Children are dismissed, and ushers, if you would come forward, please, to receive our tithes and offerings this morning. Dear Father, we do thank you once again for the beauty of this day. Thank you for this place. Thank you for your people. Thank you for providing for us. Thank you for these tithes and offerings. Praise your name. Amen. Amen. are going to continue to exalt his name together as we stand and sing, "I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb." Aren't you glad? Say, "Thank you, Jesus. He died for us, and now I am redeemed. I'm redeemed. Praise the Lord. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I am saved from all sin, and I'm walking in the light. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I'm redeemed. I'm redeemed from the darkness of the night that so thickly enveloped my soul. In my heart there have gleamed rays of light where the waves of thy glory now roll. I'm redeemed, praise the Lord. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I am saved from all sin, and I'm walking in the light. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I'm redeemed by thy blood from the power of the grave and the victory of save when I plunged in its fathomless depth. I'm redeemed, praise the Lord. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I am saved from all sin, and I'm walking in the light. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I'm redeemed from all sin, and I'm walking in the light, and thy Spirit no fear now within, for the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flieth by day. I'm redeemed, praise the Lord. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I am saved from all sin, and I'm walking in the light. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Sing and shout as you meet and greet. mm.
as we get ready to go to the Lord in prayer this morning, how many of you remember about a year ago today, this week, this weekend? Yes, Pastor Dawn and Carrie, we were blessed to have them come. That song that we sang this morning, Carrie said she didn't realize this when she was picking out the music this week, but the Lord our God is ever faithful. You will lead us through the darkness, and forever we will say, you're the Lord our God. They sang that the first Sunday, introduced that to us the first Sunday they were here. And I remember it just hitting me like, that's where we're at, Lord. Right now we're in a little darkness, but you are ever faithful, and you're going to lead us through it all. And awesome, here we are today, a year later. Don't you feel like we have grown as a church? Praise God for his faithful servants. And as we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, we have requests. Myrtle, Carrie's sister-in-law, we need to keep her in prayer. Thad Fisher, Shauna and the IYC convention and all that good stuff coming up. Rose, Heather, and Rochelle, these are Ashley Fite's sisters. Dylan Park, we need to remember him for a job. Chris Young, Police Academy, going to the Police Academy. Let's keep him in prayer. Dave Bailey, good to see Dave here this morning. Special Unspoken, Karen McCartney, she had her hip surgery this week and she did well, but I'm sure she would appreciate our prayers as she continues to mend. Remember the cantata that's coming up? There's a great message in this cantata, so just pray that hearts will be tuned in. Rick Fisher, he's going back to work this week. So yeah, praise the Lord. Alicia Watkins, traveling. Thomas Grant, this is Carrie's grandnephew. Steve Treese, Carolyn Brown's mother-in-law, May. Betty Myers, Ruth Lazar. Janet Drenning, or many are known to you by City, City Drenning. She's going to be having back surgery, pretty major back surgery coming up. Veronica Brown, Heather Rose, and Bill Peffer. And before Carrie leads us in our prayer song this morning, I believe Roy wants to come up and share a little about Paul and the status there.
Maybe a little rough. It's been a long time since I stood up here, but maybe a little rough for me to get through this. Paul does send his thank you for the prayers and everything. But it's been a long road for Paul. October of 04, he was diagnosed with lymph node cancer in his throat. He had that removed, went through 32 sessions of radiation, and he was diagnosed cancer-free. But it's a rare cancer. It moves along on the nerve system. It's a slow-moving cancer. And he went back to work, and a few years later, he was a tree climber for Pennline, or Reese Company, I mean. And he got to the place where he couldn't climb the trees to trim them. He found out he had knee problems, and he found out that the cancer had moved into his lungs. After he went to Hershey, he had some tests done. But Hershey failed to tell us that it also went into his bone. So after about 3 years in Hershey, which was a waste of time, we transferred him to Philadelphia, a doctor down there. After some sessions with the doctor, he said there was a clinic in New Jersey that works with this type of cancer, and there's a pill up there that would probably 80% curing. So they made the trip to Philadelphia. My daughter and Bruce took him up. When he got there, they said, we can't help you because you don't live within 30 miles of the clinic because we got to keep tabs on the vitals and everything. And not only that, you lost too much weight. You wouldn't be able to stand, so they shipped him back home. We didn't know what else to do. So the doctor in Philadelphia put him back on chemo up until December. He finished that session of chemo and They gave him a month's rest, and they took x-ray down. He took the treatments down at Chambersburg, so he won't have to run to Philly every day. They took an x-ray, and it wasn't no good. Matter of fact, some of the cancer growed a little bit. So last month, he went to Philadelphia for his checkup, two-month checkup. And the doctor told him, he said, no more chemo. Can't do nothing for you. Then the doctor told Stacy, he won't make the trip home. When he got home on that Wednesday, 2 weeks ago, I thought we'd be over curses. That's how bad he looked. But thank God he got through that. And that's one thing about Paul. Every time, it didn't matter how small it was, a positive thing, he was always thanking God. I could hear day after day, through the daytime, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. When he woke up in the morning, thank you, Jesus. And they went through the session of giving me the pain patches in Philadelphia, and they got that regulated where you didn't have much pain. Well, he lost so much body fat that his body couldn't absorb the patches, painting the stuff on the patches. So they put, last week, we started him on another pain medication that worked, it's supposed to numb the nervous system. We started that on Friday, and here he goes again through all this pain, trying to get the pain adjusted for the new medication. The last night was the first full night's sleep he had in about 8 months. He went to sleep about 10 o'clock last night and didn't wake up till about 5:30 this morning. We thank God for that, and he did too. You know, it's been a rough road for him because sleepless nights, a lot of them, for me and him both. And he truly wants to thank you, people, for your prayers. Mostly, he thanks God for what he's done in his life. And I've had people ask me about the T-shirt, Paul's Last Wish. And we were thinking about, see, Paul don't have no shorts for burial. And me and Stacy was thinking about some fundraisers, how to raise some money. Danielle got into the act. I was thinking about 7 years old, maybe six, she started a softball tournament, Passmore, Mike Passmore tournament. Paul was, 4 years ago, he was a recipient of that. And Paul's last wish was to have a shirt made up, to be buried in. That's what this is for. The money is going into a fund for that. And I just want to thank everybody for the love. Paul, he knows in this era, you know, what's going to happen. He realizes his time's short, and that's God intervenes and does a great miracle. So he wants to send his love. Thank you.
Stand. King of my life, I crown thee now. Thine shall the glory be, lest I forget thy thorn-crowned brow. Lead me to Calvary, lest I forget. I forget my
Morning. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you in prayer, first of all, we just thank you for the many blessings that you've given us. We know that each and every one of us here today have something to be thankful for, and we thank you so much. We just pray, dear Lord, that you be with this country, be with these politicians as everyone is getting bashed, our country is getting bashed, but yet we still live in the greatest country in the world, and we thank you for that. But yet, with all these things to be thankful for, we come to you with a heavy heart this morning, dear Lord, with all these prayer requests. You know each and every one of them, physically, spiritually, mentally, whatever the prayer request will be, dear Lord, we just pray that you will have your hand in that request and heal it. We know that you have said if we be faithful to you, that you will be faithful to us. And we ask you for that prayer this morning, dear Lord. And we thank you so much for this church. Thank you for Pastor Don. As we hear the sermon this morning, we pray that you will speak through him, that someone will be touched. And we have so many blessings. And as we go this week, we pray that you will be with us. Guide us and protect us, and may we always do your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to see you all this morning. Lot to think about, a lot to pray about, a lot to be excited about. It's a good time. I'd like for you to turn with me to Matthew 25, if you would, and as I've said to you several times over the last couple weeks, we know that Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. He's steadfast. His face is set for that place. He knows exactly what the outcome is going to be, and he has prepared himself. He's made himself ready for that. And then we come to this place today, and We come with an anticipation of within the next couple of weeks we're going to be able to celebrate one of the greatest happenings in the history of the Christian church, the resurrection, life. Having that privilege as a result of what Jesus Christ did for us. Being able to call upon Him and realize that He is there in our time of need and that He always will be. Realizing that we can come together to worship together, that we can fellowship together, that we can come in unity together. All of those things are just tremendous things. And we rejoice in that. Just like we sing those songs, we find ourselves rejoicing in the things of Jesus and what He's done for us. But today, even today, we find ourselves in an epic battle, a momentous battle, I think we could say. The forces of good and evil are kind of squaring off against each other. They're taking their stand, I guess you might say, against each other. Even as we celebrate and look forward to this time, this special time of year. But Satan and his, I want you to listen closely today. I hope that I can share with you what's on my heart today. Satan and his cohorts, I guess we could say, with their only destiny meaning being a darkened dungeon, an eternity of shame and suffering, Satan is mustering his forces, if I can put it that way. And every one of them are perfecting their armaments. And this is all, if you will, in a major offensive in order to defeat or to fight against the kingdom of holiness. We're in a battle. There is no doubt about that. But Satan and everybody that's aligned with him knows that their days for substantial gain are growing shorter and shorter. For you see, when we deal with the adversary, when we think about Satan, we have to realize that the Scripture says that he is cunning. We have to realize that the Scripture says that he is conniving. We have to understand Scripture tells us that he is a liar and the father of it. But also we have to understand that he knows Scripture much better than we do. And he knows, beyond shadow of doubt, their time being short. I've already said that, but he knows that our Lord is coming again. He knows that. So he's doing everything that he can to get his purpose in place. And the emphasis, if I can say this, the emphasis of Satan's army is toward the annihilation of everything that stands for anything that is good or anything that is just. It's what he's all about. And every one of us need to realize that. Every one of us need to find that in front of us all the time. The prince of the air, that's what we call him. That's Satan himself. Listen to me. He's recalled his generals, okay? I really believe this. He's recalled his generals, and he's taken personal command of all offensive maneuvers. And he's barking out orders. Listen to me. He's barking out orders with a vindictive nature about him that aforetime has never been witnessed before. Not until this day. I believe that. I believe that with all of my heart. And I think I can safely say to you that Satan is calling the shots. He's in control. And right now, at this particular day, he likes where he is. And he likes what he's accomplishing. But remember, his days, their days are growing short. But unfortunately, and really unknowingly, not even recognizing, I guess that I could say that, many people today are playing directly into his hand. Even today, even this morning, right now on this Sunday morning, when we enjoy the presence of fellowship with our brothers and our sisters, when we come together to enjoy the convenience of the house of God and the protection, if you will, that we feel in this place. There are so many people that have simply shied away from anything called truth, anything called justice. And it's almost as if they've personally deployed themselves upon the battlefront of destruction. And that is so sad. Satan with a vengeance, listen to me, with an absolute vengeance, seems to have an unrealized grip on so many of our friends, on so many of our neighbors. And yes, even on so many of our loved ones, those that we love so much. You see, nobody is exempt from his onslaught, if I can say it that way. Our grandfathers, our grandmothers, our fathers, our mothers, our sons and our daughters, and all of those that we love so much, none are exempt. None are exempt. And it seems that he has such a grip on them, and it also seems that he's totally in control. We look around us and we see that. We look at the broad top and we see that. We go over the mountain and we see that. We drive to another city and we see that. We drive to another state. And we see that and we understand that more and more and more and more every day. He's totally in control. It seemed like he is rendering people oblivious to the coming destruction that awaits them. Do you think it's a time to pray? Do you think it's a time for the church to come together and pray? Do you think it's a time for the church to try out to God, to cry out to God, even in our time of celebration when we think about that resurrection morning? Do you think it's a time to pray? You see, without rescue of salvation, helplessness and hopelessness await those who are living just like they were in the day of Noah. Reveling in a life that seems to be caught up in nothing but a party, so to speak. And immunity from all sin. Seems like they think that's their destiny. Sin doesn't matter. Or sin doesn't apply to me. And it seems like we see that so much today and how dangerous that is. Satan, listen to me. He's drawn a line in the sand, so to speak. And his major offensive is in full force. And he's in control of so many. But behold, listen to that. Behold, anytime you see that word in the Word of God, look at it closely because something good is about to happen. Something good is about to come. And behold, my God comes with power. Amen? Can you agree to that? Can you realize that when we read this book, that it is so obvious to us that God totally, really is in control and Satan thinks he's just got it made? But when I think about that, and I think about Matthew 25, and I see so many things here, I realize that my God's mighty hand shows absolutely no mercy to that one or to those many who are intolerant to the things of righteousness. Shows no mercy. But yet, Jim, he's a God. He's a God that still reaches down to the meek and the lonely, the meek and the lowly. He's a God that reaches down to the weak and the abused, the oppressed and the destitute. He's a God that reaches down to the maimed and the helpless. And he's a God that still reaches down to every one of us, every one of you that are willing to do what Paul said in the book of Ephesians, everyone that is willing to put on the whole armor of God. Willing to put on that whole armor of God so that we might be able to stand against the enticing allurements of the devil, the wiles of the devil, if you will, the ravishing of Satan himself. God says, I'll help you to stand against that, above that, if you'll simply put on the whole armor of God. God's eternal determination. His eternal determination. I really believe that when I think about God's eternal determination, I'm thinking about his master plan for victory. I think that's his determination. There's going to be a plan in place. That plan is already in place that is going to bring about victory. For you see, I really believe that God, think with me, he is going to be able to bring the forces of evil to bay. Can I put it that way? I think of so many things when I think about that, but I believe he's going to bring the forces of evil to bay, and he's going to force them in a corner, my friends. This thing called evil, these people that are evil, Satan himself. And he's going to force them into a corner where there's absolutely no way out. Back them against a wall where that wall is simply going to be too steep for them to ever ascend. And it's going to result, I think, in an absolute free fall, if you will, into an eternal destiny of deprivation for those who are evil. I think it's God's plan. But unlike Satan, you remember I talked about Satan's generals. He's taken charge, man. He's recalled them. But unlike Satan, God is calling his people. God is putting his people in place. He is unleashing his generals, if you will, and he is absolutely giving them total charge of his battle plan. I wish I could explain that better. I wish I could do a better job of that. You see, I really believe that God is watching from his lofty place that he sits on right now. And when the battle begins, I believe that God is going to raise his arms in victory. And it's going to be totally unlike that story we read about in the Old Testament. You'll remember it, where Moses, as long as he was holding his arms up, his servant Joshua was winning the battle. But when his arms were weakened, Joshua and his army began to lose. So what happened? Hur and Aaron, they set him on a rock, and each one of them, one on one side and one on the other, they held up his arms, and Joshua could see that, and the army of Israel was victorious. Let me tell you something. God doesn't need any help. He needs no assistance in holding his arms up to victory, Steve. He is totally capable. He can do this for himself, and he will hold his arms in an elevated position that will allow each of us to obtain victory in the things that he has for us. The outcome, what will it be? What will it be? What can we imagine it will be? Let me tell you what it's going to be. It's going to be the absolute extinction of evil. And then every one of us will have an opportunity to take advantage of that long sought after meeting with the Prince of Peace in the air. Think about it. We'll have that opportunity. We'll have that opportunity, church. We'll be able to meet him in the air, and then we'll be able to go to be with him for an eternity. We'll be able to live in that big house. In that big house that Jesus said, I go to prepare for you. I prepare a place for you. And I believe with all of my heart that he is still diligently, entirely, he's working in order to put that house in place. And absolutely provide for us and be ready for our arrival. I believe that. Man, I believe that, matter of fact, with all of my heart. And the church says we ought to be looking forward to it. Amen? We ought to be looking forward to it. Let me tell you something, my friends. I believe this. Yes, that battle line, it's definitely been drawn. There is absolutely no doubt about that. And even though there are many still that seem so indifferent to sin, even though there are so many that seem absolutely content to disbelieve, to not believe, I personally believe that God has put His finishing touches on His victory plan. I believe that He has written them in stone. I believe that He has taken His finger and He has etched the outcome of that plan on a rock. On a rock that we can stand on, a rock that we can believe in, a rock that we can take our stand on. But listen to me. Even though it's all coming, it's going to happen. You can believe that it is coming, yet God is merciful. We serve a merciful God. Listen, He is not yet called out. He has not yet given His summons to His Son and said to Him, "Go gather My children." He has not yet said to His Son, "Go gather My church." He patiently, listen to me, He patiently gives time for the lost, Denny, to be found. He is patiently giving time for the wayward to find their way. He is patiently giving time for the hopeless. To realize that there can be an eternal laughter down deep within their hearts and souls. God is doing that. And if you're here today and you're lost in sin, He's patiently waiting upon you. Behold, behold, listen to that. Behold, my God comes with power. He comes with power. Matthew 25. Listen to it. Listen to what it says. And remember, Jesus is on His way to Jerusalem, but He's still teaching, man. He's still working. He's still doing everything He can do to find anybody He can to bring them into the fold. Can I put it that way? But listen to this. God's kingdom, I don't know if you've ever thought about this before, but God's kingdom is like 10 young virgins who took oil lamps and went out to greet the bridegroom. 5 were silly and 5 were smart. 5 were silly, 5 were smart. Think about that. They all had, you know, when we look, there couldn't be any more of a difference, if you will, in these 10 young women, if you will. 5 are just sharp as a whip, man, and 10 of them don't, they don't have a clue. But there's one thing. There's one thing that every one of them have in common. Every one of them have in common. They know beyond a shadow of doubt that the bridegroom is coming. Did you hear me? They know. There is no doubt that the bridegroom is coming. Listen to this. God's kingdom is like 10 young virgins who took oil lamps and went out to greet the bridegroom. They know He's coming. 5 are silly and 5 were smart. Now let me tell you, Carrie talked in our Sunday school class about this morning a little bit about ignorance. Everybody knows what ignorance is, right? Let me say this to you. We will never, It will never happen. Ignorance will never be eradicated. You realize that? There's always going to be some that are going to be silly, but then there's going to be others that are going to be smart. And just continue to look at the story. The silly virgins, look at this. They took their lamps, but no extra oil. No extra. This is the key to the whole thing here. This is the key to the whole story. Imagine, just imagine with me if you can for a minute, our military, as mighty as it is, all the high-tech stuff that we provide for them, all of these weapons of mass destruction, if you will, that we put in the hands of men and women, but what would it be like if we provided them no ammunition? What'd it be like, Dan? They'd be helpless. They'd be hopeless in the face of the enemy. Listen to what goes on here. The silly virgins took lamps, but no extra oil. They had no ammunition, man. Whose fault was it? They had no extra oil. And listen to what it goes on to say. It says the virgins took jars of oil to feed their lamps. They had a surplus. They were prepared. They were ready. They were optimistic. They were looking for something. They were anticipating the coming of the bridegroom. But then the bridegroom didn't show up when everybody thought he was coming. Do you hear that? Listen to this. The bridegroom didn't show up when they expected him, and they all fell asleep. Now, you all can all relate to this. This is no big thing, okay? We can all see this coming. It's just like when you men sit out in a recliner in the afternoon, not bedtime, but in the afternoon, and all the lights on, man, just to, you know it's all on, but you just get out of it anyway. And you fall asleep, and you leave everything on. Well, what are you doing, man? You're laying there asleep and you're wasting all those valuable resources. That's exactly what happened with the virgins, I believe. It says that they were all waiting. They were all expecting him. He didn't come when he was supposed to, so they just fell asleep. Lamps are burning. Don't have much oil to begin with, and I've wasted all of my resources. Think about it. And then in the middle of the night, someone yelled out, "He's here. The bridegroom's here. Go out and greet him." Let me tell you something, folks. I don't have to say anything about what that says to you. Our Lord is coming again. He is coming again, but he is coming when he's going to be least expected. Are we going to be ready? Are you going to be ready? Are you going to have a surplus of oil, or are you going to be lacking? Are you going to be lacking? What's going to be the story? What's going to be the story with you? I'll tell you what, Matthew 25 is not complicated. Matthew 25 is so easy to understand. Are we going to be ready when he comes? And he's coming again to gather his church, a church that is without spot or blemish. And those are the ones that are going to meet him in the air. And the 10 virgins, listen to this, the 10 virgins got up and they got their lamps ready. Preparedness, right? All of them got up and they got their lamps ready. But then the silly virgins said to the smart ones, "Man, my lamp's going out. I'm out of oil. Give me some. Give me some. Give me some of your surplus. Give me some of all that oil that you have." And what was the answer? Resounding, absolutely resounding, "No. Ain't going to happen." That's what we see here. Look at this. The 10 virgins got up, got their lamps ready. Silly virgins said to the smart ones, "Our lamps are going out. Lend us some of your oil." And the virgin said, "No, absolutely not." And listen to how they answered. Listen to this answer. "There might not be enough to go around. Go buy your own." There might not be enough to go around, so go by your own. Some would say, I really think that some would say, well, man, that's selfish. That's selfish. A surplus. You had enough to go around. Why couldn't you give it to somebody else? I'll tell you what it was. It was smart. It wasn't silly. They were ready. They were prepared. Are you ready? Are you prepared? Are you prepared for the king's coming? Are you ready when he simply rides across the doorway of your life and he says, come unto me? Are you going to be ready? Are you going to listen? Are you going to hear that? Are you going to respond as God would have you to? Listen to this. There might not be enough to go around. Go by your own. So they did that. You see that in the scripture? So these silly virgins did that, but while they were out buying oil, out trying to replenish all of this resource that had been eternally wasted, the bridegroom arrived. And when everyone who was there to greet him and had gone into the wedding feast listened to this statement, the door was locked. To me, my friends, that is an absolutely sobering statement. The door was locked. The door was shut. It's kind of like Lazarus and a rich man. Lazarus looking up out of hell. Literally looking up out of hell, begging that Lazarus might come down and touch his tongue so that he could have a little relief from that torment of the flame. But what was the answer? What was the answer? There's a door shut, man. There's a door shut. There's a chasm. There's a great chasm between you and me, between you and us, and nobody can pass over either way. It's too late. The door is closed. Do you hear that? The door was locked. Are we ready? Are we ready? Or are we waiting for some more convenient time? Are we waiting for Easter Sunday when it'd be a great day? And oh man, that'd be a great day to save, you know, to be saved. Are we ready? And listen to what else this story says to us. Much later, the other virgins, the silly ones, showed up and they knocked on the door saying, Master, we're here. We're here. Let us in. Let us in. We've made it. We've finally made it. You know what I think he was really saying to them? Have you ever really spent any time getting ready? Have you done that? Have you ever spent any time getting ready for my coming? For you know what he said to them? Listen to what he said to them. Man, this is sobering also. He said, do I know you? Do I know you? I don't think I know you because you've never spent any time with me. You've never been concerned about me. You've never been concerned about that life that you've been living while you've been reveling in a party style and was never concerned about eternity. You never prepared and you never got ready for my coming, but today is the day of salvation and you've missed it. And this story ends up by simply saying, so stay alert. Carrie, would you all come, please? It ends up by saying, so stay alert. You have no idea when he might arrive. No idea. I'll ask you again, are you ready? Are you prepared? Have you spent any time in preparation for the coming of Jesus Christ? Have you spent any time in preparation for even perhaps death that is going to last for eternity? Have you spent any time in preparation of getting a soul ready to fly off into eternity someday and spend that eternity with Jesus Christ? Have you made that preparation? There's no way that I can make it for you. There's no way that your husband or your wife can make it for you. There's no way that that prayer warrior sitting beside you can make it ready for you. You are the only one that can make that preparation. The Lord is calling his generals to fight his battle. You know who his generals are? They're the preacher, the pastor, the teacher, the evangelist, the board member, the team member, the prayer warrior, and all of you who have been willing to put on, to take upon yourself the whole armor of God and stand against the wiles of the devil. You're the only one. You're the only one that knows whether or not you've strapped around you this belt of righteousness. You're the only one that knows whether or not you've put on the helmet of salvation. You're the only one today that knows whether or not you are carrying the sword of righteousness. And you're also the only one that knows if every one of them are lacking in your life. And it is so important that we be ready to stand together.
Jesus, he is calling. Will you come to him without delay? He is full of love, so kind and gracious. He will surely save your soul today.
You'll do that, and you'll do it today. Are you ready? Are you willing to come? Are you willing to come and give it all to him? Give everything that you have to him totally, completely? Have you ever done that? Have you ever done that? Have you ever really done that? Or have you just been playing with this thing for a long time, man? It's important. It is so important, and it is so important that we realize the condition in which we live our lives today. Are we ready for the coming of Jesus Christ? Battle lines are drawn, man.
Sinner to your precious soul, be true.
What side are you on?
Will you come to him, the Lord?
Whose forces are you fighting for?
Will you come to him for mercy call? Will you come to him and prostrate fall? Will you come?
Bow your heads with me, please, just for a moment. Father, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for your presence here. And when we think about Matthew 25, we thank you for your truth. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your patience, giving us that time that we need to be ready. Are we alert? Are we alert to the coming of Jesus? Are we alert to this thing called eternity? Are we aware? Are we really aware of the ravages of sin and what it does in our lives? Will you come? Sing one other verse, would you, please?
Will you come to Jesus?
Anybody need to come
and
pray today? Anybody? Don't come if you don't need to.
Brother Larry, would you dismiss us, please?
Dear Heavenly Fathers, we just thank you for the service that we have had today and for hearing your word. We just pray as we go out this week that we will take you with us, introduce you, and give you all the praise for all that we have. We pray that you guide, protect us, and may we always do your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.